Welcome to Rocky Like a Hurricane Rana. We're back. We're not in our normal studios. We're a bit more laid back this week. We don't know where this show's going to go.
Nope.
We're just going to see what happens. It's Simon. It's Owen. How's it going, Owen?
I'm good. I'm very tired. It's been a very big weekend. I'm sure it has been, but I'm good.
We're going to push through.
We are going to push
through. You are living the dream.
I've been living the dream this week, haven't I?
I'm sure we'll touch on it a little bit through this chat. Our guest this week, very special guest, MCW superstar, Jake Andrewartha. Welcome.
What's going on?
That's a pretty piss poor. MCW superstar, Commonwealth Games bronze medalist, yes, and Olympian. Former Olympian in Judo, Jake Andrewartha. There we go.
It's
a little
bit better. It's old news, but I'll take it.
All right. The ego needs a bit of a pump there yourself.
Yeah. Cool. So, what are we going to talk about?
Everything and anything, I think. Because I think the first time I met Jake, we literally bonded over my patch jacket because I was wearing my patch jacket and then we just started talking about metal. And the further and further we kind of started talking and getting to know each other, the more I knew he listened to actually really good music.
Well, because you're always a bit apprehensive when you first... I think it's more so with metal because we're so used to defending ourselves our choices because obviously the general public, you like that screaming shit whatever that is. And you're like, oh, yeah, but it's like this, but... So it's harder to reveal what you actually like, I guess, as we've gone on, we've actually shown, oh, what kind of different paths do we go down.
Yeah, so, absolutely, yeah. It's very cool.
That's funny. That's a similarity between wrestling and heavy metal, though. That's one thing we haven't discussed, but as a fan, bringing that up is weird. People are defensive. You don't know if someone's wearing an AC/DC or an Iron Maiden t-shirt. Do they really like the band? Is it just fashion? I think we've all been burnt. You try and talk to that person, they don't know. You feel like an idiot.
That happened to me.
So, yeah, you do have to sort of approach it.
That happened to me at work the other day because I was wearing my patch jacket at work and this guy walks in because, like, the back patch on my jacket is Killers by Iron Maiden. It's my favorite album, like, ever. And this guy walks in with, like, one of those, like, ASOS or, like, H&M, like, shirts, like bloody Dip Dyed and like Killers, Iron Maiden. I'm like, oh dude, cool shirt. And he looked at me, he just like walked out of the store because he knew I was about to open a can of worms that he could not even like get into. He was like, and just like walked out of my work.
He had nothing for the conversation. He's like, not this.
You are exactly right though with wrestling. Like I, one of my best friends, like it was about 2 years into our friendship before we even mentioned wrestling. Yeah, and it's always the case you kind of say the entry level kind of stuff, like, oh, yeah, Hulk Hogan, hey? That was pretty cool, or whatever, stuff like that. And you go, oh, what about this? What about this? And then it clicks and you look at each other and you just realize, like, oh, yeah, you're
Did
in
deep.
You're
best friends?
You're in deep. Yeah, I can fully just nerd out on you, so.
Yeah, everyone starts that conversation the same. Yeah, it's Hulk Hogan or The Rock or Steve Austin. And then it's like, yeah, I used to watch. And then someone will say, I still watch it sometimes, then you'll start from there.
So. Yeah. You seen that bootleg ECW? Yeah, something like that.
Actually, with that, I was working at a radio station a couple of years ago, and probably for 6 months, I didn't know that one of the other announcers there liked wrestling. And he brought it up in the weirdest way I've ever heard. It wasn't like, oh, do you know The Rock? We're talking about like just work politics and stuff. And out of all of like the analogies he could make, he's like, yeah, he's like, you know, I don't know if you like it. He goes, but I was listening to a podcast about wrestling. I don't know if you watch wrestling. And they were talking about a wrestler called China and blah, blah, blah. And I just stopped him there. I'm like, hold on. I know exactly what you're talking about. I do like wrestling. And then he's like, oh, yeah, it's exactly like that. And yeah.
Well, it's like speaking a language. It's terminology. Exactly. It's just like, I understand what you're about to say. Speak fluently to me.
Because I think he was trying to use the analogies of like, trying to make similarities between pushes and being held down. And it was such a weird thing.
It really is. Yeah. So, Jake, we'll try and make this interviewee as well. I'm thinking of questions on top. Because this is the first episode that me and Simon have not planned at all. We're just like, let's just throw some stuff out there.
I'm glad you really thought that much of me to not make any kind of plan. I'm sure everyone else had a plan, but, you know, it's just...
Yeah, it's just no, we thought so highly of you. We're like, Jake can handle it. We don't need a plan.
He's
good on the mic, yeah. But so, as I said before, and as some people may know, like, you're a pretty well-esteemed, like, judoka.
You did well. It's been murdered, way murdered, worse than that before.
So, did that get you into wrestling, or did wrestling get you into that? Was it kind of like a... two different paths and then you kind of discovered
so what wrestling was first.
Yeah,
wrestling was first. I found judo along the way. I wasn't the typical, I guess, what most people have an idea in terms of an athlete, like where they've always loved sports and gone into things and always had a purpose. But judo found me. I kind of found judo in a sense, and I wasn't a sporting kind of kid. I've always been the bigger kid.
Yeah.
Coordination was not my friend. and funnily enough, where judo is one of the most coordinated things you need, but the difference of that is I was kind of, you know, shown step by step, and doing other sports, it's kind of assumed that you know the skills already, especially with, like, with footy.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Like, I wasn't really keen on it, and I didn't. And when I did actually try to attempt to do it, people assume that it's like, you've been kicking the footy since you were 4 years old or something like that. And it's my first time, so they never really took the time to really break it down for me, and they just assumed I wasn't very good.
Yeah.
But with judo, it was a different way. I was step by step kind of went with that, and I guess it goes hand in hand with wrestling because it's slamming people.
Yeah, so exactly.
And I've always been drawn to that kind of thing. Like, oh, you know, as a kid, like martial art movies and obviously wrestling, like a lot of physicality. Even though I find myself a very passive person at times.
Yep.
Always been attracted to, this.
Yeah, cool. So what was your first wrestling memory?
First wrestling memory. Now, if I go here, I haven't even been able to confirm this to the day. So what I've found with a lot of things in life that I like, I'm actually attracted to things first because of the humor.
Okay.
So, and like with music as well, like when we go down the rabbit hole later, I'll like explain how I found a lot of this music.
Okay, I'm interested.
One of the first things, my first wrestling memory, I think it was a King of the Ring, and it involved Jerry Lawler, and there was an angle of someone. I've looked it up. I can't find it, but him just getting chased around and whatnot like that, and I couldn't. It's the faintest memory. It's the faintest thing. So it was on some video my brother gave me to put this on, and I couldn't help but laugh at just the premise of King of the Ring being a child. I don't know if what that comes to mind, what that means. So I'm sitting there laughing, King of the Butthole. And that was my first memory from there. But then it just kept kind of creeping into my life. Like, yeah. Ostar, that's your Foxtel for goers, Galaxy.
Because you're from country South Australia.
Australia. So Fox Sports, I remember seeing Stone Cold and Mike Tyson. I remember seeing that just after it happened. And I had no idea what the hell was going on. I didn't even know who Mike Tyson was, but I saw there was all these guards separating these guys. I'm like, who's this guy?
It's probably big time,
And you think, what is this? And, I'm just like, wow, this is cool as. And then I kind of didn't know where to find it again. It just kind of went away. And then there was one of the TNT, which was one of the old channels. It was the broadcasting channel for all the old black and white movies. So as a kid, I wouldn't touch it with a 20-foot pole.
Yeah.
But then WCW was on there. I was actually, I started off on WCW as well. So I remember watching Benoit and Booker T. They had a series, heaps of series of matches. I was massive Hogan. And
that would have been like 97, 98 or?
Yeah, 97, 98. So I got to catch all that kind of stuff that was happening. I didn't realize, years later, kind of realized the significance. And then just from there, I kind of just got more sunk into it. Then, it got to the stage, obviously, where, Fox 8 had all the rights to everything. Yep. And, even before that, where Fox Sports still had the right to Raw. But I made my mum get me the package for, pay TV had Fox 8, because Fox 8 had SmackDown.
Yes. And that's when SmackDown was prime.
That was the bet, that's when all my friends that used to make fun of me, they were like, haha, you like wrestling, it's not that cool, but they'd watch SmackDown because Rey Mysterio was the coolest guy going around. He's just flipping around, and then they're I'll watch it for that. But they sink into it, and then they end up enjoying well. So, and then obviously it all came to Fox 8, so it was easy.
Sick.
Yeah.
Quick sidebar, how good did Rey Mysterio look in the Rumble?
Jesus.
Like, holy shit, yeah. He's he looked amazing. So ripped now.
Yeah.
Like, how did that even happen?
He looked good.
Because his last WWE one, he was all flabby and all, ugh, and now he's just like a fucking machine.
I think he wanted to make up for it. He's like, oh, you booed me last time, did you? Look at these abs. Yeah, it's good.
Extra tats help, I think.
Yeah.
Helps with the vascularity.
Very much so.
Not that I know, but, you know, this is my guess anyway.
Yeah, that's why I've got all the tattoos. I'm like, I don't want to work out. I'll just trick people.
Yes.
So at that time, were you doing judo as well while you were a fan? Like at that,
yeah, age? Yeah. Like I said, judo came up. Yep. 1999 is when I started. So obviously, the same there. So yeah, that's
prime time wrestling. At 99.
Like, yeah, really, yeah. Oh, like man. For me, the most like ruthless aggression era is that. That's my.
That's my
yeah. jam. That's the best Raw theme song. Union Underground
across the nation. It's a really good one.
We ranked that third in our countdown.
I was very defensive about it. I fought for it though.
Did We're All Together Now win or that? No.
Is that, what did we put? We put
the Attitude Era. Yeah,
we did. Yeah, we just had to. It's like
I know. It has more nostalgia and
we had the first Papa Roach theme. There's the second because that's
really on man. Like I like Papa Roach, but no,
hey, it's not as bad as the one they've got pumping on Raw at the moment.
Yeah, but it's I can accept it. It's just the times, especially when you're PG, you have to tone it back a bit.
I think Union Underground, that song really did work as a Raw theme song, but I think Papa Roach got it because it's a slightly better actual song.
Yeah, but I don't. It just went so much with the actual intro, the video package. It was just, I don't know. It just meshed together because you could always interchange the who was in and out so much easier. Yeah. I think
it's a good argument.
As we're on,
I was just gonna say, yeah, I agree. The ruthless aggression era is the most underrated few years of the WWE.
Absolutely,
2002 to 2005. Are some of the best years, but I think everyone was in like a post-attitude era, like, oh, it's not as good. It was as good.
Well, see, I think it had better workers too.
Yeah,
well, and it had the mix. So you had, good workers and crazy over-the-top storylines.
And as an Edge fan, Ruthless Aggression era was the shit.
Yeah.
Like, he pretty much ruled that entire 4 years.
It's pretty good. All that stuff was good. Edge, you had Brock Lesnar, you had, Evolution.
Lesnar and Angle doing their thing.
Yeah.
Well, it's Paul Heyman's SmackDown. That's the best.
Yeah,
that's the best time. Best time for SmackDown ever, all time.
Yeah. So during those years, like when you were doing judo and being a wrestling fan, did you ever think the two could come together in any way? Did you think one could lead to the other?
Well, I have not said this on a podcast or such or some kind of media outlet, but as a kid, I used to say, "Oh, I'll go to the Olympics, so it could help me get noticed."
Wow.
Awesome. the thing as a kid. Yeah. And then obviously as I've gotten older, it's like, oh shit, I actually did one heart. I better make good on the promise I had to myself as a kid.
Yeah.
Really surreal, really weird when you say it, and it's weird to say that out loud, but it's always been in the back of my mind. Like it's something that's always ate at me whilst in the middle of my career, and there were times I wanted to stop, most probably prematurely, my career to actually just to finally take a nab at it because it was just eating at me. I knew if I was too old, if I left it till I was too old, there wouldn't be no chance of where I'd like to perform at the level I could hope I could do it. So,
cool. Yeah.
Wow, which I'm still a long way off from that now, but it's to still give myself that chance. So,
it's really cool.
Yeah.
It's good that you shared that with us.
Yeah, like there's a little exclusive.
There's the Facebook video clip for the week.
Sorted. That's the highlight.
I don't know when I was going to reveal that one, but it just kind of felt natural, like the show is at the moment. Right. So
I have a question in the bank, but we have to get there first. So okay. I'll open up the other door. We kind of touched on how like we were quickly talking about like the Raw themes. Was the music used in wrestling what kind of got you into the heavy side of music? Or was that a completely different
avenue? There's so many things that influence where I went. It most probably attracted me to a certain style. Most probably, I guess, new metal attracted me a lot more too. Yeah. And where I always had a connection with that. I was destined to always be into heavy music because my brother and sister were quite a bit older than me. So
I'm
8 and 10 years older. And
My
sister was like, pretty full on chick for like, you know, so she was listening to, you know, she had all the Metallica albums and that when she was like 13 year old girl, you know, that's not very,
that's pretty cool.
It's not normal. Yeah, you know, yeah. So and so she's blasting all that over the thing when I'm like 4 years old. You know, even like other, you know, Offspring, Smash, hearing that from start to finish. My brother would have that from,
so he had the punk and metal side.
Oh, I had all assets, so I've got different elements from both of my siblings. So
yeah.
It was always meant to come in that, and then as I've kind of gone along, I've kind of found my own way, so I like things a little bit separate to them. So
cool.
Yeah,
it is cool. So with that, what's like the first metal band you heard? Is it, would it just be Metallica? Is it that simple?
Oh,
or what's your first band?
Connect, well, it's really hard to say. I don't know what was the first, because there's so many, and like there's mostly a lot of stuff I heard when I was younger. I didn't realize and recognize what it was, and then later on I'd find out what that is.
Yeah,
like a big one for me is Fear Factory. So my first experience would have been from Mortal Kombat movie. So this is what I was saying before, where it's not funny, but like it's kind of funny, but it's the Johnny Cage Scorpion fight.
Oh, okay, yeah,
and
yeah.
I still reckon that's one of the best bloody fight scenes going around. And Zero Signal is the song that's playing while they're having a fight, and then. And you know, you don't really acknowledge it then, but that's most probably top five favorite songs of all time. Zero Signal, I love it.
Yeah.
I love it. So, yeah, I can't put a definitive answer on that, just because I didn't need to go out and get my own CDs as well, because I always could just delete it from my brother and sister. So I had all the good stuff already. But like my first, and then again, like my first ever album was South Park Chef Aid. I don't know.
I had that, that was my first.
I bought that when I was 8 years old.
Yeah.
I imagine. And then, like, that didn't have the heavier stuff going on, but, like, you had System of a Down with Will They Die For You?
Who was the track list?
And the very first song is Ozzy Osbourne, DMX, and Crystal Method.
Wow. That
ain't nowhere
insane.
To run.
Right.
Yeah. So it's, you know, it had the little bits there. And like, obviously I bought it just because I like South Park, and I was naughty to like one of, but then, you know, and then you kind of hear those kind of things and go on. And then the American Recordings, that's what released that. And then I find that, you know, they shared the same CD with the Arrows. Then I'd buy Toxicity, System of a Down later on. And I realized, hang on a second. One, they were on that album, and two, they have the same thing. Like, it all kind of comes together. Like, it's always weird how paths connect.
And don't forget who wrote the South Park theme song was Primus.
Primus, so, exactly. Yeah. And another big influence. This what I forget to mention, but I've played bass all throughout high school. So I'd always be attracted to big, strong bass lines. And it's not just like the metal side. I have different appreciation thing. So obviously Primus, one, because it's
Claypool's machine,
and he's funny as and just because he's insane to try and play one of his songs. I was sitting there 14 trying to play My Name Is Mud or something that. It just sounds like crap. I managed to get a 5-string Ibanez GTS 205. I can't remember.
Yeah,
I've lost all my skills, I've lost all my chops, but. So I was just sitting there trying to be the coolest guy. I was trying to be, at one stage, trying to be like Fieldy, because he's sitting there with his, bass upright like that.
Yeah.
Slap an open drop B or whatever.
Quick sidebar, I have tickets to see Primus in a couple months' time, so I'm very excited. I've seen him like 3 or 4 times. It's so good live. It's so crazy.
They've got a big light show. What's their thing when they...
I've only ever seen them at festivals. So I saw that Soundwave and Big Day Out. So it's a little bit different. So I'm actually excited to see them in like their own city, and they're playing with Dean Ween, like the Ween band. So that's
Ween was on the South Park album as well.
So yeah, because him and Les Claypool are best friends. So, but on that South Park album, there is Ozzy Osbourne, but there's Rancid as well.
They did Brad Logan.
Fucking Rick James, Devo, More Primus. There's some pretty interesting bands on there. So.
Yeah, that's the variety. Not the heaviest.
Joe
thing,
Strummer from fucking The Clash. From The Clash. Mm. So very cool. Very eclectic taste, I guess.
I think that was a good time for people to easily get into heavy music, though. So, you know, kids were into South Park. You end up being influenced by that. Wrestling at the time had a lot of that music.
But South Park influenced wrestling culture as well. Oddities. Well,
that's true. Yeah, it all connects.
Golga with buddy the big Cartman thing. And that was, it was the popular thing to do. Like, like I said, as a kid, watching South Park when you're meant to you because it's an adult show, but somehow it was acceptable. I don't know. It was a weird time.
I think because it was a cartoon, and back then there weren't as many adult cartoons, so the parents were like, oh, it's just a cartoon.
They
didn't know what we were listening to.
Absolutely.
So, Jake, just tell us about what music you're listening to. Like, because obviously we've touched on like what got you into heavy music, but what's spinning at the moment? What's tickling your pickle?
Spinning.
At the moment?
It's always, I find as I'm getting older, it's harder for me to kind of get out of my comfort zone sometimes.
Yep.
Like it's always me revisiting bands I've always listened to, the old stuff, or obviously listening to the newer stuff.
Yep.
The only more newer kind of stuff I've liked from scratch, like Ghosts. So, because I wasn't because you always see the image first, and I didn't know what to kind of expect when I first, just from a visual kind of presence.
Yeah, because when I first saw Ghosts, I'm like, oh, there must be a black metal band.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah,
not at all.
And like old school, like kind of like Yes and like Moody Blues, kind of like prog rock more or less.
Yeah, yeah. Which I'm big because I love metal and that, but I'm not huge on black or like death or doom. I need some kind of melody in my singing.
Yeah,
I'm the same.
Yeah, yeah. And like and I contradict myself for that because these guys are just, you know, they, you know, you can just scream the whole time, but it's just different. It's more distinctive. Previous guest Fun Time Phil said it's an acquired taste.
It's
something you really have to kind of work towards, and I just don't have the patience for that, really.
We've done some work. We've done a video together for Kill Your Stereo the other month where we talked about like what gets you into like in the mood.
Whatever.
And like you mentioned, you're a Kamaira fan, which I think is pretty cool because that band never gets talked about.
No, they don't get as much credit as they deserve. And for me, Kamaira, like that's one of the bands. Like, you know, you always have the guys who wish you could, as a wrestler, you wish you could write your song. That would be one of the guys.
Really?
I just like how punchy it is. It's just real. Just like, I think even for me, where it's, I guess, more slams and just the impact, it's just really, I think they encapsulate a lot. I can visualize a lot of like stuff happening listening to the music.
Well, so I feel like that mid-2000s metalcore was good for wrestling because, well, Killswitch Engage had like four songs used for wrestlers.
They were part of the new wave American heavy metal. Chimera as well.
That like bled into like the mid-2000s like metalcore movement, which was like, Randy Orton, fucking TM Punk, all used Killswitch Engage songs. Randy Orton for 1 week.
But it's that sound. It does work.
And it was this Fire Burns too. And like, Roderick Strong, he's like he's a very like well-known like metalcore guy, which is kind of cool.
Yeah, so. And Seth Rollins, of course, loves his metalcore.
Yes, as seen at Parkway Drive shows.
Mm.
But there you go. That's me contradicting myself now. Because Mark Hunter, he's just he doesn't know not yeah, that much melody with him really, but that's, but I don't know, there's those singers that you know who that, you know, just by hearing them, like, and but with a lot of the other bands I can't just make a distinguish.
That's completely fair. But a band that when we started this podcast, I'm like, we gotta get Jake on, just A, because he's one of my favorite people in wrestling, B, because he listens to good music, but C, he listens to Mastodon. They're his favorite band. And I know Simon likes Mastodon, and I do like Mastodon myself.
I love them. I think they're great.
Back to the funny side of things. Like most people, a big thing for me discovering bands is watching their video clips. I was a video clip hunter.
Yep.
So obviously, you know, internet not being, I'm an old guy.
Yeah.
not as accessible as it is today. So trying to find, you know, you couldn't just go find a video clip and just download it and be happy with it. I had VHS, watching Channel V, whatever I could to try and find this obscure, just watch hours and hours and hours of it just so I could find one decent video clip. And, you know, that's how I discover a lot of things and found stuff. I used to buy all your metal hammers and that from my... I'd buy like 8 month out of date metal hammers because I live in rural South Australia. So
little sample CDs that come with metal.
That's how I got half my stuff and the DVDs. But one of the first things I found was Blood and Thunder. And the video clip for that was just like this clowns going crazy.
Yeah. I reckon I had that same issue of Metal Hammer. I discovered them with that same clip.
No, way before that, my friend.
Yeah, earlier.
Maybe
I guess they would have released that as a single, like, before Blood Mountain came out, so around the Leviathan time. Yeah, yeah, it was. But, like, between those two albums at some point. So what would it be? 04, maybe?
Yeah, 04 would be,
possibly. Yeah, I remember seeing that clip. I'll be honest, like, because I read in the magazine first, and they were like, Mastodon, this is, you know, this huge album, that's amazing, blah, blah, blah. That was the first song of theirs I heard. And I reckon I replayed that song in the DVD like 10 times, and I was like, I don't get it. Yeah. I never understood that song, and I still don't.
No, well, and like, I think even for me, I think they were kind of acquired taste. Yeah. And then I found stuff as I go along, like I found Mother Puncher, which was from the album before. Why am I forgetting?
Remission?
Remission, yes. Yeah. Remission. And then, obviously, just as my interest is starting to peak with them, that's when... I told you, this is where I...
Blood Mountain or Crown of the Sky?
Yeah. Blood Mountain came out.
Yeah.
And then Wolf is Loose and Buddy Crystal Skull and all that kind of stuff. That's when they made the first big tour with Slayer and the Unholy Alliance... Two or something like that. That's
like Children of Bodom and Lamb of God as well. Was that one?
Yeah, the big one. Yeah,
I have that DVD.
I think Blood Mountain, that was the album that fully got me into them. I still think it's their best album.
No,
I think it's one of the best albums ever.
No, it's good. I'll fight anyone to the death on this. Yep. Crack the Sky.
Oh, Crack the Sky is their most underappreciated. I think it's
underappreciated.
I feel like people don't give it the credit it deserves.
Oh,
I think it's awesome.
I don't know. I most probably just got tunnel vision on it, but it's so nothing compares. And like, I've never seen a bad comment about it. But that's that won me over. Like, that's I'll put that on now and listen from start to finish. Like, I got jealous when I was hearing that they were playing that from they were doing that some of their set lists is just playing it from start to finish. And man, like the riffs on that is just chunky.
I feel like the Tsar is such a sick song. It's a four-part song too.
Yeah. The Tsar and the Last Baron to have two songs that long, but that fucking good. Yeah.
The time changes. Totally worth all it. Oh my God.
And then the ending solo of the Last Baron that basically ends the album. It's like a two-minute amazing thing.
I'd heard of Mastodon for ages, and all my friends were like, I could listen to Mastodon. I never really gave him a listen until Soundwave 2012, because they played before Lamb of God. With Soundwave, I have like this crazy memory. I can remember every band I saw for all five Soundwaves I went to and the exact order I saw them in, like this set.
Oh, wow.
So I saw Trivium, because I love Trivium.
Yeah.
And then Mastodon played, and then Lamb of God. So it was like
that's a good
side by side stages. So it was Trivium.
Was that the year? What year was that? 12. Yeah, but was that the Metallica year?
It was Slipknot and System of a Down.
What a year.
It was a fucking good. But so Trivium played. I'm like, well, Lamb of God are on. I've got no one else to watch. So I'll watch Mastodon. They blew me away. Like, and especially, that's what I like, experiencing bands for the first time live as well. That's how I like to listen to bands for the first time. And because they were touring The Hunter, because it was 2012. That was during The Hunter tour, and I was so impressed.
The thing I like about The Hunter is most probably got offshoots from Crack the Sky, the most probably material that they've still had from that. Because I think with Hunter, it's still got a lot of that sound still.
The Hunter's good.
Hunter's good. I got to stop holding them to the expectations. They'll just release another Crack the Sky or Crack the Sky 2.
What I think makes Mastodon fantastic is they have three lead singers.
Yeah, but that's the thing why I like about Crack the Sky, because that's when it was the first album that truly became they truly became three separate entities in terms of their singing.
Yeah,
it was kind of hinting at that on Blood Mountain and all that kind of stuff. But they're even from the very first track, Oblivion, it's just you hear that from all different facets.
Yes.
The nasally of
from Brent.
Brent, I reckon the best thing that ever happened to him was getting bashed over the head with the bass. But was that because they said it was Shavo Dadogen from System of Down? They said it was
supposedly.
It's most probably not true, but then he had that big trouble, and that's when he released that after that.
That's crazy.
Yeah,
that was at an awards show, wasn't it? The MTV Awards. They had played with the Foo Fighters and something, and a big brawl broke out.
He got hit in the head. I've forgot what the actual story is. Yeah. But it's just coincidentally after that they just released that
very good album. Yeah,
brain damage is great stuff. Yeah.
Well, what do we think of, like, if you know, I feel like some people with Mastodon, they sort of they lose them on the later albums because they don't like Braun singing, like the drummer. They think it's too poppy when he does vocals, but I like it. I think it breaks it up.
I like the album they released last year.
If you can't, appreciate singing, you can't appreciate his drumming because it's so like it's. He's so thinking. Bare bones basic, but it's fucking, it's so good. Like, it's not like, as in like, because I'm saying from a setup standpoint, you hear him play and you look what he actually has and it's like, that doesn't quite match up. You think there's so much more to it, but no, it's I've got no problem.
Yeah. Well, he's said in interviews that the other band members have sort of pushed him to sing more because, you know, they've told him he's the best actual singer in the band.
Yeah, in terms of melody and stuff, yeah. Like, it really is. It's just, like, I know people most, like, the thing, reason why Mastodon's most probably my, favorites because I actually think they're the most consistent band going around. I know there might be I don't know where people might think of that, but it's easy to play it safe.
Yep.
It really is. They're always trying to do something different and they change their sound. They might kind of go back to a bit, but they're never just the same guys releasing the same stuff. You might keep it's like Slayer, like, you know, you've heard one Slayer album, you're going to hear them all. I love Slayer, don't get me wrong. Or like, there's a million bands that have done it, but I think they're willing to keep pushing it, and I'm accepting of that.
Yeah.
I'll give it a try, and there's enough there for me to enjoy, even if I might not like certain bits. But the thing is, I'm not holding them to the expectation of crack the sky every time.
But I don't think they have a bad album in their catalogue. Seven albums in or whatever. No. Not many bands can say that seven albums in, they don't have a bad album. Well, every album is listenable and very good.
What I think helps with that is because they've released seven albums, but they've had the same lineup since 2001.
Yeah,
that's true. They had a singer like before they even released anything, like a standalone singer.
In my opinion, if they lost one of them now, they're done.
Yeah.
They might be able to pull it off, but it would never be the same. I think it's just, it's those four guys, and
I think having the same lineup for 17, or coming on 17 years, is, like, shows how important it is, as you said, like, a consistent, like, having, like a 7 out of 10 album, like, every time, or, like, more
yeah,
than that.
I actually think, like, the last album really was good, Emperor of Sand, it was good. I preferred the EP they put out after it.
Oh,
that was even better. Yeah, Cold Dark Place.
I haven't listened to it heaps, but I know what you're saying there. Look, I'll be honest as well. Like, some of the newer stuff isn't on, you know, repeat as some of the others for me. That's for sure. Like, Hunter, I can still, like I said, because that's still got a lot of bits from Crack the Sky, I think. Like, Round the Sun.
Once More Around the Sun. I actually like that more than the Hunter.
Yeah, it's got good stuff on it. But I think, as in terms of there's most probably some better singles on that one.
Yeah.
But in terms of an entire album, it's not as good.
Okay. Yeah, actually, you're probably right. I could pick out songs from Once More Around the Sun that I really like, but then there's a bunch I'd drop
because
I don't know them. It's totally worth it. There's like four songs in a row where Brent just shreds, plays like these outro solos. For some reason, that was almost a pattern on the album.
The solos
came at the end of songs, and then it would just cut out.
Fade out, yeah.
Yeah, they were just like, it's the end of the song now.
Yeah, it's really weird. I'm done now. Which was different,
you know, compared to the old days where it was like super progressive and long and whatever else they would do.
Yeah. Well, that's a big thing I like is what I seem to find what I like on my music is the layers.
Yeah.
That's the thing what Mastodon does. It's not just guitar, like, there's such a soundscape to it, if you know what I mean. And I guess that's what some of the stuff I'm more interested in as well, even is with Chimera and the Fear Factory is stuff. Yeah, just all the different layers, because, you know, especially with industrial is most probably, I think it's my favourite genre.
Okay.
What
bands?
Fear Factory, but then there's something you can kind of group it into that, but it's actually not that genre. Like, I'll say Strapping Young Lads in there as well, but it's not really, I don't know, like, you say it, you know what I mean, it's hard to define, but it has elements, but you know what I'm kind of saying. So it's And then there's like guys that are lighter, but they still get grouped into that. So like I'm a big White Zombie, Rob Zombie fan.
Okay,
so,
yeah,
so,
cool.
So, and, but they, I know they get chucked into that. Rammstein, I'm, oh, I've like, that's one, especially with this kind of digital age, they're one of the few bands I'll like go out and buy the physical release.
Okay,
a lot
yeah,
of stuff.
Cool.
Mastodon's in that group. There's a few bands that I will make the effort and go out and buy the physical bloody copy of. So.
Yeah,
and that's, so all those kind of ones there. So
well, you open a can, you open a slight can of worms.
Yeah,
because
you didn't know about that, me, did you?
No,
I haven't really talked about it. So no, that, I'm hiding my power.
I was more talking about the strapping young lad comment. So yes. the other week we had a young Sean Hawkins on the.
He's not podcast. Young.
He's older than you. He's
yeah,
older
yeah,
than
he's not young. Yeah, he's not young.
But yeah, so he
sorry,
and he was on our best debut album, Triple Threat Fight to the Death.
Ocean Machine, I believe, was his choice.
Yes.
Yes.
Thoughts.
Oh, yeah, good. It's hard. That for...
Because I know you're a massive heavy...
Devin is... He's my spirit animal. Devin, cause, but that's the thing again, though. That's like... Because he's so funny.
Yeah.
But he's... Because that's... I guess he represents best what my musical taste is.
Yep.
No, the funny part aside, but just so varied in what paths. Like I have this big path. He hits all the basic stuff I really love the most, but then he goes experimental. Or like you know, he makes like you know elevator music almost essentially.
Yeah.
Like just
yeah,
kind
some,
of like
some
ambient
like,
ambient music, you
like
know,
like smooth jazz, and then like some like psychedelic stuff. And then there's like the super heavy riffs, and like especially on like an album like Ocean Machine, it's like heavy. Then like you have like this like ambient kind of thing going on. So.
And stuff like he's so ahead of his time as well. Like you could put on Ocean Machine now, and you know you ask, "Oh, what year is that from?" And you could say it's from around now, as in like where that sound even started. Like, because you'd think you know mid-90s that came out.
Well, that's what you said on the actual episode. The production does not sound like 1997.
That was the first time I've listened to a full Devin Townsend album because I had heard bits of Strapping Young Lad and not really got into it. But for the episode, I listened to Ocean Machine and I couldn't believe how old it was because it really doesn't sound it. The production on that is
so full.
Stunning. It's ridiculous. So it sounds brand new
and
still.
As you said before, like you like your music in layers. That's pretty much.
Oh
like,
it covers everything.
Music that you need to have headphones on to listen to,
or a really good stereo system.
Says that. Oh yeah, and just like, and you can listen going to sleep, like that kind of stuff. Like it's not too confronting that you can actually just chill to it, even though there's a lot going on. You know,
absolutely. Yeah, well, we've covered the music, and now I can get to the question I've planned since the moment
we.
So yeah, heavy music is obviously like as you said, like as you said on the Curious Stereo video, it's the soundtrack to violence, is what is your exact quote.
Yes.
And then going back to like your what people might know, they'll know you as wrestlers, but people might because I honestly knew you as because I remember watching your bronze medal match in the Olympics. I remember seeing.
Commonwealth
Games. My bad.
No, you're right.
But I remember watching. I remember because that's. I'm like, I know who you are. I'm like, I don't know why. And then
one of
like,
the very few people. Yeah, yeah.
I'm a Commonwealth Olympics whore. I love all that shit. What music did you listen to get yourself pumped up for a tournament?
So like, I like for that stuff. It's like I said, in being able to envision because a big part of your prep. With I guess any sport really is visualization.
Yeah.
So I know it's something that has to have a build and a big. So that obviously that's the thing. That's the climax of my fight or like what I'm going to do.
Yeah.
And a big drop and like you know time to be intense. So that's you know you go into your melodic kind of times where you're going through the motions and then tense where you have to attack and go for it. So there's a lot of stuff on there. I remember a weird one. Was it Kevin Steen's theme? But it wasn't Blue Smock Nancy. Before you look at other. But it wasn't the original lyrics. Some guy took his own lyrics and put like rap stuff or something like that kind
the
of
Unsettling Differences.
And I don't know for that. For some reason, that was my taste at the time. But like, even like it might not seem like that much of a pump up song, but "Weak and Powerless" by Perfect Circle.
Okay.
Yeah, I think that has a different kind of, because I think it has a lot of, anything that has a strong kind of emotional kind of reaction from there, because that's, you know, there's a lot of stuff going on there, I think. So that's, you know, that brings out a certain fight anyway, I guess.
So you were in the heavyweight division, obviously.
Yeah, super heavyweight. So like big boys. Big boys.
Big boys. So you could say like, so the heavyweight division, like the heavy music kind of made it feel, it kind of matches each other? Or
Of course. Because, you know, like, I guess, you say a lot of divisions might be, even might be different genres. Like, like a lot of stuff might be thrash. And that's why I like the big pound. Like, you know, Chimera, they were fast, but not, it was never like...
It's very, very beat-down-y.
Exactly. And that's me. That's boom, boom. Like, trudging along. And, like, if it's a throw or something, it's like just one impact, if you know what I mean. Like, just really...
A big thump on the
big
floor,
big thump, yeah. So that's, I think that's where, like, where the lighter weights might be thrash or something like that.
Yeah,
you know,
like
the
speed
and quicker and fast.
Very cool.
All right, now I reckon we should just like ask some. I think one thing we haven't done with our guests is just sort of some rapid fire questions that everyone should answer, because we're getting these different answers from sort of everyone.
Yeah, yeah.
Because I'd like to, because we change theme every episode, it would be good to get like a consensus on certain things.
Okay.
So
the bad one of this is you ask me all these now, you come back and ask me the same questions, like I'm going to give you a
different answer. Yeah. We'll do a follow up.
Yeah.
So, like, favorite wrestling theme song.
That's the thing. Like, I built a reputation to have a certain response to that. Now
we'll give you two. Maybe we can give you like two answers, like favorite metal wrestling entrance, but and then just
all the good ones. All right, so the stock standard answer to that is Mike Awesome's theme.
Awesome,
because it's just so fun to sing with, and that's what Mike Awesome. It's just what he did. He was sent, like, soundtrack to, like, he was the violence of that helped the soundtrack to violence.
You had a guy who was 6'7" and like
6'6".
6'6".
Yeah, like the lyrics say.
Yeah.
Yes. My apologies. Angry and mean.
But he was just like, because like at the time it was like you had like the giant or the big show, but like the giant who was the same size, but he was just like big. Whereas Mike Awesome was like super cut. Super like shredded, but he was 6'6" and just threw people. Well, he threw Spike Dudley out of the ring into the fucking crowd at one stage. So like that's why, because like
he's a springboard. Like what the,
and he was doing like top, like he was like doing like tope suicides off like over the top rope like into the crowd, and like so like I guess his wrestling style matched his theme song.
Yeah, well. And it's just hard. Like it's hard. His impact. Like that's in terms of. You know, when people say wrestling influences,
yeah,
he's up there. Like
I see you wrestle.
I want to be a buddy, a Mike Awesome cross of Taz, pretty much. That's why I kind of want my
sick.
That is the most ECW like answer ever, but it's good.
My answer is going to be pretty much pro ECW. So, yeah. But I think that's where I think that's what I kind of am. I don't know. I must be completely wrong in some way more lame than that, but. Yeah, that's why I'd hope to be.
Yeah.
Okay. That's my stock answer.
Standard Jake answer.
Yeah, Jake answer. But I'm actually big on Ken Shamrock's theme.
Oh, okay. It was really good.
Yes. That is a good one. Because I'm a huge, huge fan of anything that has church bells in it. You chuck church bells in a song, I'm there. So there's boom. Because like I said, it's that single boom. It's real like... It's got a bit of sinisterness to it. Yeah. It's all because generally church bells. It's related to death. Related to death as well. It's some kind of danger there, another one just on the top of my head, like Venom Inside by Chimera. That's a big. Yeah. That's got a big on church bells there as well. Like so all that kind of theme and Ken Shamrock's theme is awesome. I love that.
We quickly talk about entrance themes. The entrance theme you used to use is your singles entrance theme at MCW. I love, because it's a remake of
so it's a three-way remake of for people's because I get asked this question a lot. I get messages like, oh, what's your theme? It's like, is that all you want to know about? I mean, anyway. it's So I'm big on video games as well.
Yeah.
That's one of the many other things that's influenced my musical taste and all those kind of things.
Yeah.
But it's the Killer Instinct theme. So if you're a fighting game fan, it's the Killer Instinct theme. Composer, Mick Gordon.
Yeah.
I don't know if that rings any bells to some people.
He does the current Doom. He does the soundtrack for the new Doom
current Doom soundtrack.
Yeah. I saw him perform that live on like one of the video game shows. Yeah,
it would have been Rip and Tear.
Yeah, couldn't believe it. It was insane.
He did the soundtrack for the Xbox One, I guess, relaunch of Killer Instinct.
Okay.
He did the classic theme and all that. Again, that has not church bells, but it's got blacksmith kind of hammer, like ding, like that kind of thing going on. So his take on that, but then covered by a YouTube guy named Little V.
Okay,
so cool. He's taken that kind of. His McGordon's kind of inspiration, and then taking that and turning it because
he does his own thing.
Where his version's a lot more soloist, a lot more, I guess, heroic,
more shreddy,
and like other little, like, you know, verses and stuff like that. Where just the stock standard kind of McGordon ones is like start to finish, kind of repeat, kind of deal.
I saw Mick Gordon actually play some of the Doom songs at PAX the other year.
That would have been
awesome. He's awesome. He's Aussie too.
He's Aussie.
It was
so sick. I'm like, I may as well stay now. It's so good. Heavy as fuck.
Yeah.
Meshuggah type heavy.
Someone should get him to do a wrestling
thing. Well, that's what they said. Track him. That's what we're like. Yeah, so
it should be your goal before you retire, Jake. Get Mick Gordon to play with
things. We'll see. Not enough time.
All right, so what about worst wrestling theme song?
Oh, American Males, that's always one. I got to think of something more obscure. I'm just gonna I love him. He's one of my favorites. But Cesaro's theme, it just shits me to death.
Oh, it's terrible.
I hate it, mate. It's
Do you like it?
I
didn't think anyone liked
I'm,
it.
I'm neither for or against. I just kind of. I think I like it now because it is mixed with Sheamus's one.
He's never had a good theme. Yeah. He had that Dean Malenko one with Swiss rap or whatever.
I like that one for some reason. Okay, I thought it was okay.
But for someone of his stature has never had quite a theme up to his kind of level, I feel anyway.
I feel like for someone of his stature and brilliance, he's just been done nothing in WWE anyway.
I'm not one.
I'm a big Cesaro fan, but he's been just treated pretty poorly. I don't think
it's transistence. It depends what you determine as success.
He should have been world champion like 2 years ago.
I don't know. I'd like to have his paycheck. I think that's pretty successful and still hired and still working. Maybe he's okay with that.
Yeah, exactly. For me, the worst theme song is still. I just like saying it because it pisses people off. But Randy Orton's "Hey, nothing you can say." I fucking hate that song.
I hate that song. Yeah, there's a lot of nostalgia.
I don't mind that,
but it's I can see where you're coming from in that because it's quite kind of like a real teenagery, I guess it's attached to that kind of emo kind of stuff. If you're never a fan of that, people would be on your case about that. I really can't think of the top of my head. There'll be so many I could get into, but
yeah,
Cesaro one's a good choice. For current stuff, it's pretty bad.
For in terms of what they deserve, I think. Yeah, Cesaro's theme.
Fair enough.
Okay, what about favorite music wrestling gimmick?
There's only one band hammer, isn't there? Whether
it's the Honky Tonk Man or Elias or, you know.
The Rockers.
I actually didn't mind Jeff Jarrett.
Really?
I don't want to be popular, but his WWF run, it's...
With his guitar.
Yeah, I actually don't mind that. I just can't... There's not that many really good music kind of thing wrestlers.
There's a lot of rappers. I guess a lot of guys have sort of rapped.
There's no metal guys. No good ones anyway, I think.
Yeah. Has it ever been done right?
Like I said, Van Hammer, Van Hammer used to terrible. Try and play to the ring and stuff like yeah. that. He's crap.
There was Man Mountain Rock in like the 90s in WWF. He was like this big fat guy who played a WWF guitar. He wasn't very good either. Then there's the Rockers. Yeah, they're on the fence because they look it.
That's the mean. It's different because like you could just say Chris Jericho, which would be the best one because he's just a rock star.
Dolph Ziggler.
Yeah, and Dolph Ziggler, but... But I'm
with these patches.
For me, this sounds like to me like an actual gimmick that has music kind of attachments to it. It's not that's what kind of defines what they are.
Yeah.
Yeah. But there's not that many really. It's not like there's no D. There's one DJ, DJ Z, whatever it is.
Does anyone remember the rock and rave infection in TNA?
No, I'm not really well versed in much TNA. Like an incurable
disease.
Well, it was what's his name, Lance Archer.
Okay,
and Jimmy Rave, and they would come out and play Guitar Hero guitars, and they would dress sort of like Slash and Axl Rose or whatever. It was a very weird gimmick when you think of it now, because no one knows what Guitar Hero is.
Sorry,
3MB.
Oh, shit.
God, good lord. Heath Slater is king. I fucking love Heath Slater so much.
He's good.
Pretty good.
I like how he still uses it. Like he's like the one man band.
Yeah. Like just one man.
I'm a one man band.
Yeah. Yeah. I always thought their theme song was funny though, because even when it was 3MB, they only redid the start of the song, and it would be 3-man band. But then the rest of the song was like references to one man band still, and they didn't bother.
No, they don't give a fuck. I don't think people give a fuck about them anyway.
Yeah, I know. All right, so we know sort of like bests and worst. What about worst metal band? Is there a band you can't stand that you don't understand why they're popular?
Before they even released that crap where they actually got hits out of it, Bring Me the Horizon.
Really?
Yeah. You just can't stand them. Oh, mate. Ollie, the singer?
Ollie Sykes. God.
Oh, I'd love to do things to his face with my fists.
I like how you saved that, by the way.
Yeah. Oh, no, him. Oh, God. There's a few. There's a lot of passion behind that one. And then they made money. Lots of money.
Yeah, that's what happens when deathcore bands decide to just change their
sound. I think that was just purely selling out.
I thought they progressed sort of through the albums. It was going there, like if you listen. I was the same as you though early on. Like when I was hosting a radio show like 10 years ago, we would not play Bring Me the Horizon because I hated that guy so much. I was like, I'm never playing him. I hate Ollie Sykes.
He's such a terrible, annoying.
He's a real prick.
He deserves everything he gets as well.
I interviewed them once and it was really weird. Like it was what you would expect from them. They were an hour late. We went into the hotel room. The rest of the band were there. And they were like, yeah, sorry, Ollie won't be doing the interview. He's in the bathroom. And he was in the bathroom for an hour. We don't know what he was doing there. You can only imagine. But it was sort of put me off on him personally.
No, that's no good. I'm too old. I don't know what's hip for me to be angry at.
I think you picked a good one, though.
Yeah.
That's a good answer. So. Yeah,
it's a band that gets everyone talking anyway. Because you get like the people like me who have like listened to them since like they were a deathcore band, going, oh, not this shit now because they're fucking not even heavy metal. Or you get people like who listen to them as deathcore band, going, oh no, they're better now. Like, make up your mind.
Mm. Well, if you want, there's bands that have turned me around.
Oh yeah, that's good.
There you go. Yeah. Parkway Drive.
Really?
I hated them.
Yeah.
No, you should be happy. I like them now. But do you
like the new or the old stuff?
For the longest, I don't know. Sometimes you just get a bad taste and you just can't, for some reason, you can't shake that. I hated their old stuff.
I used to hate their old stuff.
And then I don't know what it was, but yeah, they turned me. So, and that was a big thing. I used to think, you try hard, whatever. Like, nah, they're real deal. They're good.
I've seen that band like 15 times. Like, it's just mental. But the first two albums, they were produced by Adam D from Killswitch Engage.
Yeah, I know. Yeah,
so that's why they're so goddamn heavy.
Yeah. No, it's interesting. Some of the like Australian bands, their history.
Called the Prom Queen as well. Like they started out pretty terrible, but like they got really good.
They never won me over.
Really?
Yeah.
Never won you over.
I only liked Columbia necktie.
Yeah. Your shirt looked better with a Columbia necktie. See, they're Adelaide boys. They're from Adelaide as well.
I know. Well, here's the one. Okay, now we're going to the school stuff. I don't know if everyone will know. Some of my favourite bands also... Or another one from Adelaide, a Double Dragon. Did you ever listen to Double Dragon?
No, but listen. You should. If you want, all right. What we should do is next time he's in Melbourne, we'll get Jake back on the show. But Robbie Hart, and we can just have those two talk about Adelaide metalcore bands.
I think they've faded off into obscurity. But one of my favorite songs, Black Sails of Armageddon. I first saw them at Soundwave 2009. They did.
They're the local openers.
They're the local openers.
That's where I must have heard the name, because it does sound familiar, but I know I've never listened to them.
And then I don't know if you would ever. I don't know. Like, this goes back to industrial stuff. I'd consider them industrial, kind of. I don't know. Test Eagles.
Okay.
There we go. So Test Eagles. They had kind of a hit that was on hottest. They made Triple J hottest years ago. Okay. Turn that shit up. There was that. Very new metal-y, sorry, as well. They're big. One of the few bands I got in that much into as a kid that I'd go on their own like forums and stuff like that and that led to my, because they influenced like Cog and stuff like that. I'm big on Cog, so progressive and melodies and blaze, it's all that kind of stuff. Some little obscure kind of things. I'm a big fan of Aussie stuff as well.
What are the Aussie bands you listen to then? Just in general.
I'm not up to date. Who's the good ones now? But you're big on Cog. Now I can't think off the top of my head. Shit.
Well, if you're into Cog, you could. Have you heard of Sleep Makes Waves?
Yeah, I know Sleep Makes Waves. I couldn't do it. Really? I didn't mind. Carnival was okay as well. Yeah.
Pre-Birds of Tokyo or
Pre-Birds of Tokyo. Yeah. Was that Themetta or whatever it was?
That album is so good.
And there's more stuff I can think of. I'm very good at saying useless information when I'm not really getting pressed for it.
I'm not on the spot in the pressure situations. Next time I'm talking to you at MCW show, I'll just click record.
Go with what you want there.
Well, this has been a fun, free-flowing sort of whatever type show. I've
really enjoyed it because we've just talked. We haven't had to like look at a spreadsheet and see what's up next. We can just
or time, like, are we fitting everything in? Have we covered everything? Or I feel like we covered studio things.
Time running out?
Yeah, none of that.
It's a pretty good studio here, boys. I think so. Now, thanks for hiring this out for this occasion.
Not a problem.
It was a private booking. Yeah. And you're paying for it. That's how this show works.
But I appreciate the free flow when I went to all this trouble of, researching and everything, and none of it being used. So,
what did you research then?
I don't remember.
I was going to say, just get out all the facts you research right now, just like trivia.
Go right now.
If anyone could see us right now, like, this looks how it sounds. Relaxed. We're on couches. You guys are in shorts. You know, we're just like chilling. Whatever.
I'm literally just going to go straight to the gym after this is done. Anyway, I'm going to press finish. I'm just going to go straight to the gym, lift some weights. And do nothing.
I'm not.
Probably eat fried chicken when I get home.
I ate fried chicken before I got here.
Ooh, smart boy.
Now we're ending on fried chicken. Where do you prefer your fried chicken from?
In my mouth. Ooh, from Japanese 7-Eleven. So there you go.
That's an entire hour episode I could talk about. Lawson's, Family Mart, 7-Elevens. Dude,
Japanese fried chicken.
Japanese fried chicken is a glorious.
Or Korean, Korean fried chicken. Korean fried chicken
is good. But if you go in Japan, if you're walking into a convenience store, which there's many of in Japan, and there is a window with fresh fried chicken for $1.10, you gotta buy it.
Damn.
And corn dogs that instead of like, you know how like corn dogs in Australia are battered? It's a fucking donut.
American dog. No, do you know what the best part about it is? Is the actual sauce and mustard, because it's got tomato sauce and mustard in the same thing.
And you snap
and you spread it and it pours this perfect little line, not like, you know, how it just jettisons out with the sauce here. But there it's just out, perfect little lines. Oh, that's my favorite part of it.
Japan is a glorious
place. This has nothing to do with wrestling or music.
Japan, you need to go to Japan.
Well, I'm planning on going next year. Well, so when I go, we'll have the next episode and just talk about food.
And we'll get Jake on. We'll
exactly.
Because Jake, you've been to Japan like what, a couple of
Have a guess.
Was it 18?
19.
Damn.
19 times since I was 14 years old.
But that was for Judo.
For
not fun stuff.
And I've been it there once for Wrestle Kingdom, so I think I win this.
You win. You win.
And I will go again for fried chicken.
Damn straight.
On that note, we're going to wrap it up. Jake, thank you very much for joining us on the show.
Thanks for having me.
We look forward to seeing you.
Have me again.
And we'll have you again. Now, absolutely.
You need to have me again.
We will. We'll have a proper planned episode. We might even do a theme episode when you come back on. Well, I'm looking forward to seeing you at MCW whenever you're there next.
Oh, and who knows when that will be.
Yeah, exactly. Anyway, we will see you next time when we rock the Pokemon.